Good morning. It's good to see all of you. Please take your hymnal, turn to page 369. Methodist hymnal, be the red hymnal in the pew there. Turn to page 369. Let's sing the first and last verses of Blessed Assurance as we begin this morning.
Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song. All the day long, this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I am my Savior, I'm happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. Song, praising my Savior all the day long.
It's good to see all of you this morning. Welcome to Mt Bethel, to our homecoming service. We got a few things planned this morning between this time before 11 o'clock and the regular worship service starts. And as we start this morning, I go ahead and ask Charles Whitey if he'd come forward, and I think he has some information to share with all of us about the church's history and so forth. Charles?
Do I need to come up there, or can I get down here closer to the people?
For the purpose of Facebook and what might be streamed, you might need a microphone.
Okay, I'm going to be yelling at you.
All right, well, I really don't know where to start, because we were talking out here, and I've been a member of this church for 60 years. Okay, so where do I begin? It's like the theme from Love Story, is that right? Where do I begin to tell the story of how great a love can be? I'll just sing. I didn't know I had that talent, Mike. I'm going to tell something on Mike. I might as well go ahead and get this over with.
Be careful now.
Be careful. We're careful. Mike, we were in a meeting or something, and he said, do any of you know Henry Melton? And I said, yeah, I know Brother Henry, or I've been to a service. For those of you who don't know, Brother Henry started Faith Tabernacle down here. But anyway, this was back when he was on Thompson Street, and I got invited to a Sunday night service over there. And I said, okay, I'd heard some things about it. And I go over there, and Brother Henry starts preaching. And he kind of gets happy. And then he goes into this, up and down the aisle kind of thing. And I'm waiting on Mike to do that here, but it hasn't happened yet. But we're just waiting for this to happen.
I have the green light now.
Okay, I don't know how far we want to go back. How far do we want to go back, Wendell? Way back there? How about that now? Okay, well, here's a few of the tidbits from the archives that Amanda gave me. I'm not going to read all these, but we're going to touch on a few. There was a time when the men and the women didn't sit together in our church. And then Aunt Fanny, for those of you who are not familiar, in the old house right down here, this is where Aunt Fanny lived. And somebody help me on this. Did she get together with her husband in kind of a mail order thing or something? I think they got together. You know, now you have Facebook and all these kind of things. Well, I think they got together that way. Betty, there you are. I was looking for Betty. Betty's the church historian now. She's taking over for Brother McDonald. But that's right. They got together. But anyway, after he came from up north, and they sat together. And apparently that broke an old tradition from the women on one side and the men on the other. After they sat together, apparently other couples started sitting together. Okay, Deborah, I saw Deborah come in. She says, we've got it now. There was a time with the service was thick with wasps and swarms of bees around the crown molding. Deborah, hold your hand up. There you are. Do you remember saying that? Did you reveal that to someone?
I don't remember
really saying that, but it's the truth. I remember that well. I can remember, you know, there being wasps flying around everywhere. Okay, and this is something I thought was very interesting. In the early 40s, was the first church wedding here. Sam and Stella Whitehead apparently were the first couple that got married at Mt. Bethel. And it says here that before that time, they would normally go to the preacher's house. And we'll tell this on Eugene Meredith. Someone got on to him for sitting in the back, and he said, this is not the back. There's the front door. Okay, those are just a few. Now, before I get sharing a couple of mine, do any of you have anything that you just have to get off your chest and want to tell the church? I see Jean Mays back there. And I kind of almost stood her up on a date. I invited her to come today, and I was going to pick her up, but as situations worked out, Peggy went by and picked her up. And it's so good to see you, Jean. Jean is kind of our homecoming queen. Well, I'm going to say she's our queen for the day. Let's see. We have Jean here. Miss Charlotte Blankenship is here. And Heather is here. I think that's all the pastors' wives that maybe are here. Little Chris is doing something there. And I'm just going to call him Chris because when Brother Ray was here, Chris came along and he looked just like his son. He did. He looked just like him. So, yeah, you look just like your daddy. But do any of you have anything you would like to share?
I remember the good old stick and stews that Brother Ray used to have.
I thought Rotha would bring that up today if she were here. Stick and stews.
That was right on the tip of my tongue. I can remember that very well. For those of you who don't know what we're talking about, Brother Ray announced the chicken stew that was going to be next Sunday, and it came out sticking stew. Back in the old days, there used to be a classroom right here. And I shared this with Angie. I'm going to share it with everybody. I can't remember exactly the circumstance. Is Sandra here? Sandra didn't make it. Oh, really? Well, you'll have to tell her, David, that I told this on her. Apparently, our teacher wasn't with us that day because Sandra was only like 2 years older than me and Angie, and we were in this classroom that was right over here. And Sandra got to talking about what talents we had. And we got to talking about talents, and then we talked about what certain tasks we did around the house. Well, as we kind of combined the two, she asked me, what is your talent? And I was thinking task and not talent, and I said, my talent is taking out the trash. And see, that happened. That had to happen 60 years ago, y'all. And I was so embarrassed by it. It stuck with me all these years. But, you know, we can laugh at our embarrassments now, right? Sure. Hopefully. Hopefully not so embarrassed. My father, he never revealed too much about the times that he came to church here. But when he was... And I'm just going to share this with you so you can picture it in your minds. Like, it always stuck to me. David, correct me if I'm wrong, but wasn't there an old chimney that came in from this side and an old wood stove that came down on that side? Was it this side?
Yeah, right over there.
Well, the only reason I say that is we didn't always have air conditioning. And... The windows in the summertime were raised, and my dad said he got in a little bit of mischief one day. Apparently, he took a live cat and threw it inside the open window while service was going on. And if you picture that in your mind, oh my goodness. Let's see. I'm going to share some of our former pastors. Of course, Brother Ray is here. And Brother Ray was the man that married me and Gloria. That was a blessing that happened 37 years ago. All this just doesn't seem possible. But the first pastor I remember was Brother McDonald. And I remember coming down to Brother McDonald's, what he called lamb service. And correct me if I get too far off, David, or someone. But we would come down, and he would always have a little brown paper bag. And we never know what was going to come out of that brown paper bag. But he always had something good for the lamb service. And the other thing I remember about Brother McDonald... Well, his favorite song is "The Clouds Are on the Screen," "Land of an Uncloudy Day," and that still—I can still hear him singing it as he echoed those songs. Y'all, correct me if I get a little bit off on the pastors here. Let me just touch on the pastor's wife. Was his wife not named Dorothy Deborah? And she had, they had two daughters. And the reason I remember it, because one year they sent us a Christmas card. And she was an artist. And she drew the two girls on the Christmas card. And that was very unique at the time to have something like that. And also, now, did Brother Bracy follow Brother McDonald? Historian in the house, help me out here. I'm pretty sure he did. I lived down in Florence, and both of them were at Columbia Cottage at the same time, and I got a chance to go visit with them before they passed. And those were some precious moments, you know, that we were able to share together. And then Brother Mays came along, and Brother Mays had two stints at our church and 10 years together. And I can remember certain things about Brother Mays, and that he always was real genuine in his attempts to let us know just how much God loved us. And I know he spent time in the Navy during war times. And if you could imagine being on a ship in war times, what could bring you more closer to the Lord than that? Anybody got any contribution, or y'all want me to just keep a going? Okay. And then for a brief time, we had Brother Don Wright. And I think he was only here for a year. And did he get married while he was here? Myra, was that his fiance's name? Okay, somebody speak up. whatever happened to Brother Don, do we know? Do you know, Ray? I don't know either. I know after he left here, he went to Huntsville, and he was telling me that he was at a church that was doing very well. It was a larger church.
He went on and got his doctorate degree, and he did preach at several big churches. The last one I heard him preach at was in Huntsville somewhere.
He retired this past year.
Really?
Yes.
Well, how about that?
He seems like he'd be too young to retire. Well, you're Charlene. I didn't even recognize you, Charlene. Now, Charlene could get up here, and she could do much better at this than I could, because she has got all those memories back in the time. What wonderful memories of my Uncle Chiz and Aunt Clayton, Charlie Green, Marvelyn Green, Miss Ada. What wonderful memories we have right there. Wendell, you got anything to add? But those were some different times, weren't they, Wendell?
Sure was.
But what a journey it's been for the past 60 years. Like I said, I've been a member of Mt Bethel Church. And just reflecting like this, I remember the changing of the seasons. We've gone through many a sunrise and sunset, and we've seen a lot of change, and we've changed. The one constant is that the Lord is with us, that God is always near to us. But, you know, it just seems like I can remember being... in the springtime, I love the springtime because I was shut up all winter back in those days as a boy. And I love to get out. And the springtime was always a special time of the year here. I remember the buttercups blooming and just all those things. And then there was the heat of the summer, and then the changing of the leaves in the fall, and then the cold and chill of the winter. But with all those changing seasons, there is something about Mt Bethel that could just keep you close to God. I would say that His Spirit has always been, you know, very evident here. I can remember names now. I'm thinking of names and people. And these people were like... they were like trees by the living water. I'm trying to do Psalms 1 here. Blessed is the man or the person whose life is in the Lord. They'll be like a tree planted by the rivers of the water. They'll bear fruit in their season. They will not wither. And many of those people were like trees. They were strong. And they were examples to us. Okay. Now, I do have a brief devotion. I want to tell something on one of our visitors who's with us today. Buck Sides, he grew up in Haleyville, Alabama. He was so poor that in the wintertime, he had to walk 2 miles to school barefoot, and it was uphill both ways. And that's according to him. So we'll have to ask him about that one when the time comes. But Buck, it's good to have you with us. And all the visitors, it's just so good to see you here today. It's just wonderful. Okay. A favorite passage of mine is comes from Isaiah, the 55th chapter, the first verse. The Lord says, through the prophet Isaiah, he says, come and buy, come to the waters, all you who are thirsty, come and buy. Come and purchase what I have for you, but don't bring any money. And I'm reading this, and I'm thinking, what does this mean? We have to have money to purchase anything. But the Lord says, bring no money, come and buy. Come and buy the bread that I have for you. Come and purchase the living water. But again, don't bring any money. And then as I read through that, I come to find out that the reason he says don't bring any money is because we don't have enough. No matter how much money we have, it's not enough to buy what the Lord has to offer. In the book of Ecclesiastes, Solomon wrote, vanity of vanities, all is vanity. And here is a man that had everything that you could possibly want. He had all the money in the world. But he's writing, without the Lord in your life, it's all meaningless and it has no purpose. So come to the Lord, but leave your money somewhere else. Earthly store does not buy heavenly things. The only requirement that it takes, it's not money, the only requirement is that you are thirsty. In other words, you have to desire what the Lord has to offer in order to receive it. If you try to buy it, it doesn't work. The only requirement is you must desire it. You must be thirsty for it. The Lord says, bring no money. The truth is, we don't have enough to buy it. Solomon was saying, all the money in the world doesn't buy meaning and purpose. Only the Lord can provide that. In the book of in the 55th chapter of the book of Isaiah, the 6th verse says, seek ye the Lord while he may be found, call on him while he is near. And as I read those words, it just kind of echoes through my mind. You know, now is the time to call on the Lord while he's readily available. Now is the time to call on the Lord. Let the wicked forsake his way, the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, and he'll have mercy on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. The word abundantly here implies not only will he pardon, this is what he loves to do more than anything else. He wants to give us the abundant life. Not the earthly life, the abundant heavenly life. This is what God loves to do. He goes on to say, my thoughts are not your thoughts, My ways are not your ways. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Y'all, give me just a moment. Let me get a little sip of water. And then he says something which is beautiful, and it speaks to the church. For the rains come from the heavens, for the rain and snow come down from the heavens, and they do not return there, but they water the earth, and they bring forth food for the eater. So shall my word go forth from my mouth, and it shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish its purpose. As I've been a member at Mount Bethel for 60 years, I can feel those scriptures come alive. I've seen it. I've witnessed it. And the Lord has blessed us very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Charles. It was only appropriate as he talked that there was a wasp that dropped from the ceiling and lit on the pew right behind Charlotte back there, reminding me of old times. That was the thing to do as a child. The ceiling was much taller back in those days. When the church was renovated, this ceiling was dropped to put this current ceiling in. And I can remember as a child sitting in the pew and watching those wasps bounce off the ceiling. And what you were watching for was to see whose hair it was going to fall in. There's always somebody waiting with a hymnal that might be brave enough to take a swing at one of them. The other thing that Charles mentioned too that brought back a lot of memory about days of old, this was so much different back in those days. The choir loft was actually just the space between the televisions, if you can envision that. And the entire stage had the Sunday school class to left and right of that, where many of us went to Sunday school, had Sunday school class. And my dad always told of a classroom, believe it or not, and I think this was the reason it was left this way, that was actually up in the space that's exposed up here. I think Gertrude Springer taught that class. And so they would climb up into that classroom up over the choir loft. Actually, it's where it was. And they had Sunday school up in that. There's a few of you in the building that might have been in that class or have experienced that. Maybe, maybe not. Okay, next thing. Let's just go ahead and have music, then we'll do that after that. Yeah. Ruth Vallejo is going to come share a song with us.
Saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear. And grace my fears relieved. How precious day. that grace appear. The hour I first believed, my chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
Thank you, Ruth. I think we're going to have a moment now to recognize memory of several folks this year. I think it's a little different this time. Normally, I think it has been in the past that we might just recognize church members. But I think this year, there's just been a lot of circumstance. We didn't have a homecoming last year. And a lot of circumstance, there's just several people that were on people's minds and hearts. And so there's quite a few to be recognized. Brother Mike's going to come do this for us now.
Again, I'd like to say welcome to all of our guests here this morning as we've come together for this homecoming event, and as we remember those that we've lost in this past couple of years. So let's take this moment to remember those names. Mr. Joe Witsit. Ms. Virginia Springer. Keith Cole. Luther McCaffrey. Elmer White. Royce White. Scott Simpson. Holland Joyner Sr. Sergeant Nick Reisner. Revelations 21:4. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will exist no longer. Grief, crying, and pain will exist no longer because the previous things have passed away. You know, today, folks, as we remember these individuals, you know, the tears will flow as there's been so much death here recently with our family and our friends. But know this, they're in a place today where there's not any, there's no more tears. There's happiness and joy. And the thing I hope you can take away today is, like Miss Ruth said, those chains are broken. Okay? Nothing's holding us back anymore. And one day, one great fine day, we're going to stand before our Lord and Savior, and He's going to say, "Enter, good and faithful servant." And all of those people are going to be standing. They're going to be standing there, and they're going to say, "Welcome. Come on in and enjoy." Amen.
Before we actually move forward in the service, I'm not sure if it's, I always never understand if it's month or day. Either way, it's time to appreciate the pastor. So it's either Pastor Appreciation Month or Pastor Appreciation Day or both. I guess it should be that all the time. But Brother Mike, on behalf of Mount Bethel, the congregation, to you and to Heather and to Mackenzie, thank you all so much.
Thank you.
I appreciate you very much.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Yes, sir. All right. If you'll join me on page 641 in the hymnal, you're welcome to use the words on the screen, either one. We're going to sing this chorus as our call to worship this morning.
My cup, Lord, I lift it up, Lord, come and quench. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup, fill it up and make me whole.
Good morning. Welcome to everyone, to all of our guests, and to those that are watching via our live feed and our FM transmitter. Glad everyone could be with us this morning, and welcome home.
Please take your hymnal again and turn to page 172. Let's stand as we sing. We're going to sing the first and last verses. Words are also on the screen if you want to use them there.
My Jesus, I love Thee, I know Thou art mine. For Thee, all the follies of sin, I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior, if ever I love
Gracious and loving Father, Lord, I thank you for this beautiful day. Father, for this time that we've come together during this homecoming. Father, the names that we've called this morning that are with you today. Lord, we just ask that you tell them we love and miss them very much. But there's coming a great fine day when we'll all be together again. And we thank you for that and that promise. Father, for those that we have on our prayer list, I just ask that you touch them with your healing hand. Give guidance to the medical professionals that take care of our loved ones and our friends. Father, I ask a special blessing of strength be upon the caregivers of the church as they care for their loved ones. Lord, and I ask you to continue to keep our first responders and our military safe as they risk their lives each and every day to keep us safe. Father, guidance for the leaders of our country, our state, our local governments. And Father, for our teachers, Lord, I ask for their strength and their guidance as they have to work in a changing environment each and every day as we still continue to battle this COVID virus. Lord, I just ask you to continue to keep our children safe. Lord, be with each and every one of us as we go forth. Father, I ask for strength that as we go forth, that we can preach the gospel with boldness. Father, I thank you for each and every person here today. And Father, those that are with us via the technology that you've blessed us with. And Father, I just ask for the words to speak as we go forth into this service, that all that we say and all that we do, we bring praise, honor, and glory to you. And Father, at this time, let us come together and pray as you have commanded us to. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Page 724 in the Methodist hymnal, or use the words on the screen. We're going to sing the first and last verses.
On Jordan's stormy banks I stand and cast a visual eye. I am bound for the promised land.
Again, welcome to everyone. You know, it's a tough time when we look back on those that we've lost. But I always tell people, you know, even at funerals, you know, when you celebrate life, it's time to look back at their life and how they impacted ours. And it's okay to laugh, and it's okay to smile and tell the stories and all that. As we come together this morning, we've told the stories of this church from when it started to where it is now, as it continues to grow, and it has. And we thank God for that. But this morning, I want us to recognize a very special person that was one of the former pastors here. I got to meet Ray a month or so ago. He came in and was he had had something that had gotten canceled or some event he was going to be at, and he decided that they were going to come in one Sunday morning and they were going to worship with us. And so I got to meet and talk with Ray, and it was a very pleasant experience. So when we were talking about guest speakers, I said, well, what about Ray? Let's just get him. And they agreed, everyone that was involved. So this morning, I want to welcome you, Brother Ray, and I ask you to come and deliver your message this morning, and we thank you and your family for being here with us. Please come.
My. Oh, my mind has just been flooded with wonderful, wonderful memories ever since Mike asked me to come and speak today for homecoming. And as I looked at these candles burning here and the ones that they are burning in remembrances of, oh, I just think about so many other wonderful people who used to sit in those pews right there and had such a powerful impact upon this congregation that it still lasts even today, and through their children. And I thought, I was standing over in a fellowship hall earlier, and I saw somebody come in that far door over there, and I said, oh my goodness, Thaddeus is back. Brad looks so much like him, and he's so active in the church here, just like Thaddeus. But my goodness, Laddie Lee right across the road over here, and the Rithmeyers, and Grady White, how faithful he was. And I could just go on and on and on with names that Winona, for example, was here. And Thaddeus, he had to be one of the best men that I've ever known. Kind of close to David, too, in that category. Just wonderful, down-to-earth people who are honest, sincere, and they love the Lord. I came here from First Methodist in Florence because I had decided to do a less than full-time appointment so we could live out on the farm where I was born now 80 years ago. My children, the older two, Cheryl and Greg, I would take them out there, pick them up at school and take them out there to the farm and let them play on those hills and so forth. Daddy, let's move out here. Daddy, let's move out here. And so we did. And today, I know you remember when we came here, Charlotte was pregnant with Chris. And Chris grew up in this church. And raise your hand if you remember this. Now, he looked just like Cade, who is Chris's son. His youngest son, he has a set of twins. I got through preaching up here, and Mike always stood at the outside of the door to greet people as they left. So I got through, and I was walking down the aisleway, And back there where Deborah's sitting, Chris was sitting with Michelle Rithmeyer. And he got loose, and he comes running across the pew, and he's like Superman, and he jumps in my arms and almost knocks me down. I didn't tell Chris that story early, Cade, because I was afraid he might imitate his daddy. Oh, but what beautiful memories here. And today, speaking of Greg, his middle son, Alex, is here with his wife, Adora, whose family came from Vietnam. And Alex and Adora, we're glad that you are here with us this morning. Boy, I can almost see those people sitting there, PB, and I knew where they were sitting, and I knew where Grady and his wife sat. Wow, it is such a privilege for Mike to have invited me to come today to speak to you. And not only that, but I know full well when I get through and we have the benediction, there's going to be some awfully good food back there for us to share. I'd like to say, Mike, you've got a wonderful congregation here. They are really super people. And I love every one of you. Truly do. Would you join me now as we go to the Lord with a prayer before we bring a message for us today? And what I'd like for you to do, and it's going to be hard on this homecoming to do this, but try to put everything out of your mind so that you can listen to the message that God is bringing us through the Gospel of Matthew. So don't think about what you're going to eat at the lunch or who didn't show up or who did show up. I want you, if you will, just concentrate upon the text and the message for today, because it comes to us from God. And it really can speak to each and every one of us in an unusual way. So I hope you will listen to that. I hope I don't go over it too much. It's 20 to 12, so we ought to handle pretty well that.
Take all the time you need.
Okay. As we bow our heads and close our eyes, and turn our mind and attention upon the Creator God, let us talk to Him now with our prayer. Oh Lord, I thank You from the bottom of my heart for this wonderful congregation here at Mount Bethel, for the love that exists between members, for the love these members have for You and Your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we are truly, truly grateful. Now, gracious Lord, in this holy time and in this place of prayer, we ask You to come into the safe and protected corners of our hearts and minds. Lord, grant us the courage to give to You what You find there. For some of the things that are there are too heavy for us to carry. Our resentments, our anxiety, our anger, our doubt, and our confusion. where you find, Lord, our hearts filled with pain and grief of loss, with sighs too deep for words, give us the peace which passes all understanding. When our doubts speak louder than our faith, remind us that you came to us in your Son, Jesus Christ, who also suffered and wept and endured and triumphed even over death itself. Lord, help us to pray with confidence because your Son gave us this promise. Lo, I am with you always, even to the end of time. Help us, O God, to move beyond where we are to what we might become. Help each one of us to take our sorrows and the taste of bitter betrayals and let them go bit by bit, so we do not become sorrowful or creatures of revenge. Help us to weave the losses of our lives into something beautiful, made possible only because of them. Let the horrors of our lives lose their power over us as we let them go in their space. Simply, Lord, let us grow love. This we ask in the name of the one who came to us that we might know love, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I hope that, as I mentioned earlier, that we will just simply think about upon what God is saying to us, because He's here. He's literally present with us, and so I hope it, our minds will just think about that, just concentrate on that as we go through this. So we don't listen to God's word with proxy, where we say, boy, I wish they would have been here. They should have heard that sermon. We don't listen by proxy as to what somebody else in the congregation might be listening to, but we listen our own selves with our own hearts and our own mind, and we concentrate to listen to that. It is so vitally important to remember every day that the way we live our lives every day matters. The way we live today matters. Because as we come to the end of our lives, we hope the door will be opened and not shut. And the way we do that is the way we live every day that God gives us to live. In one of George Eliot's books, he writes about a young man named Tito. When Tito was born, it just seemed like the world was just open to him. He had so much promise and expectations, and he was talented, he was handsome, and he was intelligent. And the world was just open to him. Just all he had to do is live it one day at a time. But George Eliot says that Tito began to slip away. He began to practice betrayal. He started fearing things. He started being unkind to people he knew. He cheated and he lied. And he always put himself first. So finally, this promising, absolutely promising man, his heart died long before literal death came. It is so vitally important, the way we live every day, so that when the end comes, we'll be there at the open door. Day by day decisions we make may rob us of the greatest treasure of all, the abundant life with our Lord. The text this morning is so many options. We could have gone there, but I've opted to use a part of the Olivet Discourse. It's taken from the Gospel of Matthew, the two latter chapters of that book. And that Olivet Discourse, and let me encourage you, as you are concerned about the way we live every day, that if you read the last part of chapter 24 and the rest of chapter 25 on a regular basis, it can be a really guidepost to you to help you along life's way, that every day you live, you'll live as though it matters what you do. The first one is taken from the 24th chapter of the last, starting with verse 45. And it talks about the faithful and wise servant. You remember that story? The master went on a journey, and he left all he had to serve it. And he said, "My servant, you know what I've taught you all these years, and you know exactly how to do it. So I'm going to leave you in charge of everything I own." Now, it's going to make a difference how you live every day. So he said, "If you do what I have taught you to do, when I come back, I'm going to give all my possessions under your control." But he said, "If you don't, after you realize that I'm not coming back as quickly as you thought, and you start beating your fellow servants, you become drunk, and you're wasteful with what I have, when I come back, there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth because you will be sorely lost. Doesn't that sound? Every person in this building right now has been given tremendous talents by God. And he says, I'm going away and I'm coming back one day. But I want you to live every day as though it really, really matters. What a powerful story. The second one comes from the 25th chapter, and I'll be reading that as a text in just a little bit. And then there is another one. It comes from the 14th verse to the 30th about productivity. Do you remember what that would be about, productivity? God says to us, he said, I'm going to give you some talents, and I want you to use it. For some, he gave 5 talents. Others, he gave 2. And to one, he only gave 1 talent. The fellows who got 5 talents, they went out and invested their talents, and it became more and more. And the one that had 2 did the same thing. And finally, the one that had only 1, maybe he was jealous that he only got 1 rather than 5 or 2. Well, what did he do with them? What did he do with that 1? He said, oh, I just got 1. I'm going to go hide it. So when my master does come, I will have it, just like he gave it to me. And you know what happened when the master came? He took that 1 and he gave it to the one who had 5, who had doubled his. To those who receive some, will more be added to it. Remember that story in George Eliot's book? He was given super talents, but he squandered it and wasted it. Had a dead heart before his body was dead. Now, let me read the text for the morning, which is the second of those. And you'll remember this one, I know. So familiar to us. But listen, and as I read it though, think about why 5 of these were wise and 5 were foolish. What made the difference in them? They were created the same. Listen. At that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish, and the other 5 were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps, but did not take any oil with them. The wise, however, took oil in their jars along with the lamp. The bridegroom was a long time in coming, and they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, the cry rang out, "Here the bridegroom comes, come out and meet him." Then all the virgins woke up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish ones said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil. Our lamps are going out." "No," they replied, "there may not be enough for both us and you. Instead, go to the store and those who sell and buy some for yourselves. Here is a sad part, and I hope it never happens to one of us in this room. But while they were on their way to buy the oil, the bridegroom arrived. The virgins, who were ready, went in with him to the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the others also came. "Sir, sir," they cried out, "open the door for us." But he replied, "I tell you the truth." What sad words. "I don't know you. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour when the Lord will come." We never know the day or the hour when the Lord will come. We don't have tomorrow. That 20-year-old that was a part of the 13 that was killed by that bomb, he didn't have tomorrow to be 21. Neither do we have promise. Especially when you get 80 years old, you don't have a promise of tomorrow. Be prepared for his coming. This parable is one of central light. It's the wisdom of readiness, being ready for it. And gosh, isn't it great that God has given us a life with all the talents we have if we just fully use them? While as a student at Candler School of Theology in Atlanta, I had various missions to do, and I really am grateful to Emory University for Candler for the opportunities they gave me. One of them, and I think Charlotte wasn't too happy about this one at first, I was to become an inmate in Atlanta's federal penitentiary. I walked in that building, that great old monstrous building, up a, seemed like 100 steps to the front doors. And I thought, oh my, what in the world am I doing here? This is not seminary, this is prison. I walk in and they give me my clothing to wear. It wasn't a purple shirt and a purple tie. Solid white with black numbers on it. And my number was different from anybody else's number in there. And this big, rough fellow came up and he took me by the arm and he said, "Okay, right, come on, you're going with me." "Yes, sir." He took me to those doors and it made a tremendous loud noise, Charles, when they unlocked. And they swung open automatically. And then they closed back in another loud clamp. Oh, my. I'm in here. How am I going to get out? And I'll tell them, "Look, I'm really not a bad man. I'm a student at Kenner School of Theology." And they say, "Yeah, some of them tell me they're Jesus Christ, too." "You think we're going to let you out of here?" And no thought went to my mind, and I went to my cell. They opened that door, and this big old guard slammed that door shut. Now, in prison, the commodes don't have a seat cover. The only thing you've got in there is a little sink, which is stainless steel, has one control knob, and you couldn't take it off. There were no bolts to undo it. The bed, there was no Tempur-Pedic. There was a mattress about that thick on a few wires, and that's what you slept on. And I looked across the aisle, and there were those ruffians. Now, they probably didn't have as many tattoos as people would have today in prison, but there were some of those too. But they looked at me with suspicious eyes. But my project was to talk to the man whose cell I was using. So I went down and met with him. He sat down across from me. He wasn't 80 years old like I am, but he was probably in his 60s or maybe even 70. And I said, "Sir, how long have you been in here?" And he said, "Oh, I've been in here since the time I was in my early 20s. I said, "Well, surely you've had chances of parole by now." "Oh, yeah. Yeah, I've had some chances, and I've been paroled." I said, "Well, why are you back now?" Right across the street from the federal prison, down that 100 steps, right across the street, there was a post office. And he says, "When I get out, I walk down that steps, I walk over to that post office, and I hold it up." I'm like, "Well, why did you do that?" He said, "Ray, I can't live outside these bars. This is my home. This is my job. And I'm going to die in here." Isn't that sad, Mike? That we can become so depressed, or we can become so obsessed with money and things that we don't love our neighbor anymore. We don't go to worship and really worship. We are too concerned about worldly things. And so when that day comes, the door won't be opened. The door will be shut. And you say, "Oh, please, please, I never knew you. Depart from me." The way we have to absolutely ensure that the door will be open is that the way we live our lives every day matters. Every day we live matters. I'm going to close with an illustration and then a little words of, I think, would be helpful. In our life group over at the church where I attend now, there's a woman who I feel like is a saint. Her name is Pat Weatherby. And she's blind now. But when she comes and she teaches our class, you sit there and listen. It's like the Lord teaching you. She tells of the time she was in the Philippines, and this woman came up to her just unexpectedly while she was looking for a place to rent. She came up to her. Maybe the Lord was speaking through her character and her appearance. But she said to Pat, she said, ma'am, would you pray for me? And Pat said, I started praying, and she knelt on her knees in front of me. And when I got through with my prayer, she looked up to me and with tears in her eyes, and she said, Pat, would you baptize me? Or I want to go to heaven. The way we live every day really does matter. If we want a life of peace and happiness and confidence and the hope of eternal life, that's the way we have to do it. May God add his blessing to that, and let me encourage you. Go to Matthew chapter 24, the last section of that, the last paragraph, and then all of chapter 25. If you read that over and over again, you'll find that door open when death comes. May we pray. Thank you, Lord, for giving to us your truths through this book we call the Holy Bible. Our prayer now is, Lord, that every day each one of us will take it seriously and watch how we live our lives. We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Mike, for the opportunity.
This morning, our invitational hymn is number 301. 301. Please stand as we sing. Sing the first, third, and fourth verses.
Jesus, keep me near the cross, there a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near the cross, O Lamb of God,
Song for the morning is 338, the first verse. 338.
Right there with you. You know, I think we forget that sometimes. We get off on that journey. He's telling us to go somewhere, and we're a little afraid. We think we're all alone, but he said, "I'm not going to leave you." And what a great thing that is. So this morning is, you know, like Brother Ray said, we need to think about what we're doing and how we're doing it, how we're living. What do people see? And as I've said to, you know, to several groups of people, when death comes, and a pastor, young or old, stands over you, what kind of story is he going to tell? How are you living your life? We need to think about that. We need to live for the Lord each and every day. Amen? Oh, now, wait a minute. We can do better than that. Amen?
Amen.
All right, there you go. Because you know what I'm fixing to do. I'm fixing to bless the food, and we're going to get to go eat. All right? I knew that would excite everybody, okay? All right. Again, thank you all for being here. When we dismiss, give the ladies just a little bit of time to go over and get everything set up. I was told to stall just a little bit. So if you'll give them just a little time, they will appreciate that. Let us pray. Gracious and loving Father, Lord, again, we thank you for this day, for Brother Ray, for his wisdom, for the message that he brought today. Father, be with us. Give us strength as we go forth. Father, we live for you each and every day. And Father, I now ask you, bless the food that we're about to eat, that it be a nourishment to our body. And bless those hands prepared it. And Father, as we depart today, let us do so with your peace and your mercy. This I ask in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.